Welcome to our worship this day. Pastor Billy will be sharing a message today. Our theme, our focus this Sunday is Trinity Sunday. Trinity, as in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our scripture, our songs, our prayers, the message will all be focusing on who God is as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As we anticipate, get ready for our worship, three things I'd like to mention to you in the way of announcements. The first is this coming Sunday, June 14th, we will be having a drive-through communion opportunity for our people. We will be taking a congregation and dividing them somewhat into three parts, asking you as part of that alphabetical list to come between the hour of 11 to 12, 12 to 1, or 1 to 2. So the total time for that will be 11 to 2. You will receive information either through our website. You will receive information, direct email communication, those types of things, if you receive our messenger and cross currents in that form. If you do not, you will receive a hard copy through the postal service that will help you remember, help you to know what part of the alphabet, what time, and things like that you are, but also how that will work, a little map of the parking lot so you know how the flow will work. We will make those things as clear as possible prior to Sunday, but we will also be learning as we do this along the way. The second announcement is we do have a regularly scheduled voters meeting that is to take place every year. That is currently scheduled for Monday, June 29th at 7 o'clock. The difference this year, in light of all the things going on with COVID and not being able to gather in larger numbers, is that voters meeting will take place online. We will be using the Zoom platform. If you're not familiar with that, we will try to get some of that information out to you as well so you are able to join in that meeting. This is a regularly scheduled yearly meeting, and at this meeting, we will approve the budget for the next fiscal year. We will vote to extend the current calls and contracts for our synodically trained people, and we will also have election of our board of lay ministry members whose terms have expired, or people we need to have new leadership in those positions based on being able to serve and no longer being able to serve. Our third thing today is Vacation Bible School is happening, and it will begin on Sunday, July the 12th. There's great information on our church website, so if you go to trinluth.org and look for the link to Vacation Bible School, there's information about how and when to pick up the package of information that you will need for those 5 weeks of Vacation Bible School. Also be able to register online, and it is necessary to register, so please look at that information on the website. If you have questions, don't hesitate to call the church office and we'll do our best to get you steered to the right place. We will begin our worship in a prayer. Most gracious Lord, we ask that you bring your blessings to us today through your word, through the voices that we lift up in singing your praises, and through the prayers, the confession that we know in our hearts we want to bring to you. Lord, thank you as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that you work throughout all avenues of our lives, and you give us a picture of who you are and what it is that you have done for us. Bless this, our time in worship. We pray that in the name of Jesus. Amen. We continue our worship. We will have a video that will be our first reading. Our first reading is that creation account found in Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 2, beginning of verse 4. So invite you to enjoy a little bit of a creative way to show and tell God's creation.
Good morning. Today's reading is from Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 2, verse 4. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters.
Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good.
Then he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness night.
The evening passed, and morning came, marking the first day.
Then God said, "Let there be a space between the waters to separate the waters of the heavens from the waters of the earth."
That is what happened.
God made this space to separate the waters of the earth from the waters of the heavens. God called this space sky.
An evening passed and morning came, marking the second day.
Then God said, "Let the waters beneath the sky flow together into one place, so dry ground may appear."
That is what happened.
God called the dry ground land, and the waters seas.
And God saw that it was good.
Then God said, "Let the land sprout with vegetation, every sort of seed-bearing plant, and trees that grow seed-bearing fruit. These seeds will then produce the kinds of plants and trees from which they came."
That is what happened.
The land produced vegetation, all sorts of seed-bearing plants and trees with seed-bearing fruit. Their seeds produced plants and trees of the same kind, and God saw.
An evening passed and morning came, marking the third day.
Then God said, "Let lights appear in the sky to separate the day from the night, that let them be signs to mark the seasons, days, and years. Let these lights in the sky shine down on the earth."
That is what happened.
God made two great lights, the larger one to govern the day, and the smaller one to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set these lights in the sky to light the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness.
God saw that it was good.
An evening passed and morning came, marking the fourth day.
Then God said, "Let the waters swarm with fish and other life. Let the skies be filled with birds of every kind." So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that scurries and swarms in the water, and every sort of bird, each producing offspring of the same kind.
And God saw that it was good.
Then God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply. Let the fish fill the seas and let the birds multiply on the earth."
An evening passed and morning came, marking the fifth day.
Then God said, "Let the earth produce every sort of animal, each producing offspring of the same kind, livestock, small animals that scurry along the ground, and wild animals."
That is what happened.
God made all sorts of wild animals, livestock and small animals, each able to produce offspring of the same kind, and God saw that it was good.
Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our image, to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, and all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground."
So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them.
Then God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and govern it, reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and all the animals that scurry along the ground."
Then God said, "Look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And I have given every green plant as food for all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, and the small animals that scurry along the ground, everything that has life."
That is what happened. Then God looked over all he had made, and he saw that it was very good.
An evening passed, and morning came, marking the sixth day.
So the creation
of the heavens and the earth and everything in them was complete. On the seventh day, God had finished his work of creation, so he rested from all his work.
And God blessed the seventh day and declared it holy, because it was the day when he rested from all his work of creation. This is the account of the creation of the heavens and the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
So as we saw in God's word from Genesis, God created everything. God created everything just by speaking it into existence. And everything that God created was good. But it did not take long for God's greatest creation, people, to mess up that good creation and brought sin into the world. And we know from God's word that the penalty of that sin is death here on this world, in this earth, in this life. But God did not want that death to be the final answer. And so God made a way for his people to be rejoined with him, to be reconciled with him. And he did that through his son, Jesus. And he did that by sending his Holy Spirit to bring and gather his people into his great big church of Christian believers all over. And one of the things God asks of his believers is that we recognize our sin and we take that sin, our shortcomings from God's good creation, that we take those sins and we lift them up to God in the form of our confession. We have the opportunity to do that now. Most merciful God, we confess that we are, by nature, sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy and in his desire to bring his people back to him, sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. As a called and ordained servant of that Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue our worship, our next song, Great I Am.
Be close, close to your side, so heaven is real and death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above singing as one.
God only. shake before you, their demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power.
The next lesson is from Psalm 8. We will begin on the first verse. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell of your strength, silencing your enemies and all who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them? Human beings that you should care for them. Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The rocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson for today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 28. We will begin reading at verse 16, and I invite you to follow along in your home Bible, no matter what the translation might be. Matthew 28, verse 16. Then the 11 disciples left for Galilee, going to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some of them doubt it. Jesus came and told his disciples, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." That is God's word for today.
Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. Howdy, y'all. My name is Pastor Billy. I'm the senior pastor here at Trinity Lutheran, and I am very excited that you are joining us for worship today, where we get to celebrate Trinity Sunday. It's a Sunday where we return to that precious name of God that has been placed upon us, and we get to see how the very name of God also teaches us so much about Him. And so I love that at the beginning of the service, that was our life group, and so many of them got to share the creation account and go back to the very beginning, where we see God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit actually all together. It's one of two places in all of Scripture where they are so clearly together at the same time. And so we go back to those first couple of verses where it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." That's God doing His primary role of creating, okay? And so God the Creator. "Then the earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters." And so there we also have the Holy Spirit. And if we join a little bit of the information from the Gospel of John, we get to see that God the Son, the Word, was present there, even as God the Father spoke the very Word that later put on flesh, whom we call Jesus. And so it's beautiful that we get to see Father, Son, and Holy Spirit from the very beginning of creation. And so in the midst of our context today, we use this name for our very church community, Trinity Lutheran. And we have a logo that really lifts up this Trinitarian image and the way that we then behave as the people of God, living out this image of God that He has created us with. So we have God the Father who created, and that is His primary work. He creates and sustains, and it's a beautiful creation. We get to see that unpacked in Genesis chapter 1. It's also a beautiful creation that we get to see spoken of in Psalm 8. And as you peer out into the clear night sky and see all of the stars that were put in their places, as you look out in the backyard and you get to see the bird feeder that has such variety of birds that come through the backyard, and even as you go shopping for your garden and you see that there's probably hundreds of variations of tomatoes, and you think to yourself, man, the creation, the creativity of the Creator God is so powerful. And even now, as we look around our culture and we're being reminded again that His creativity didn't stop with plants, but it continued with humanity as well. So there are people of all nations and races and sizes and colors, and all of them beautifully created, marvelously created by that Creator God. So we go to chapter 2 in Genesis, though, we quickly learn that there is going to be a primary job for the second person of the Trinity, God the Son, the Redeemer. You see, because sin entered into the world through the decisions of the people that were placed there, and all of a sudden now there's separation between us and our Heavenly Father, the One who created us. We decided we wanted to be in His place, and it's not just a problem of old, but it's also the problem that we deal with today, each of us wanting to be in control, wanting to make all of the decisions and have it our way, as they like to tell us at Burger King. And so Jesus was sent, second person of the Trinity, the Word became flesh, both fully God and fully man. Jesus came to redeem, to pay the price for our sin, so that we would no longer have to be separated from our Creator God, our Heavenly Father. But indeed, we could live forgiven and free. We could live with that redemption, having been purchased back and reconciled back to God. It's powerful to see that our Heavenly Father decided that in the absence of our ability to do that work for us, that He would take on that job, Redeemer. And so we have God the Father, Creator, God the Son, Redeemer, and we have the promised Holy Spirit flowing out of each of them that Jesus even spoke to. He said that I'm going to send you a helper, and we were reminded of that last week as we celebrated Pentecost and watched that take place in our mind's eye, returning back to Acts, where the disciples received the Holy Spirit. And every believer thereafter, you and me, we have the one who was called the helper or the counselor, the one who sanctifies or makes holy. We have the one who goes ahead of us and shows us a way. We have the one who stirs faith in us and then perfects that faith in us. The Holy Spirit, the helper. I love the beauty in the Trinity because it teaches us that God didn't just create and leave us in the past, and He didn't just linger longer with resentment because of sin. He sent a Savior, and He didn't just say, okay, now that's done, so good luck from now on, but He continues to work in our lives even today through the Helper, through His Spirit. We do our best to remind ourselves of who God is and the name that He has placed upon us and what that name means for us. In our very Gospel lesson, we see Jesus command us to use this name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, with the Great Commission. It says, then the 11 disciples left for Galilee, going to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw Him, they worshipped Him, but some of them doubted. Jesus came and told His disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That is present tense, ongoing, all the time, never ending presence of God. We place the name of God, the family name that I like to say, upon our foreheads, upon ourselves through baptism, when we are welcomed into the family and when we are promised the gifts that come therein, the forgiveness of sins, adoption into the family of God as sisters and brothers in Christ, so fully connected to the death and resurrection of Jesus that when God looks at us, He sees Jesus. And we receive that inheritance that belongs to Jesus that He now has fully shared with us. It's a powerful, powerful name that is placed on us in our baptisms. And every time we begin a special moment together, whether it be a baptism or a worship service, we return to that name and we make our beginning in the only name that informs our identity. The name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is our every beginning. And we even continue to receive encouragement from the likes of Martin Luther, who said, when you wake up in the morning, hit your knees and make the sign of the cross upon yourself to remind you that you were created by God, that you've been redeemed by Jesus, and that you have a helper to go with you on life's journey that day. Confess your sins and receive the forgiveness that was earned with that redemption, and then walk forward in boldness of faith, being faithful to God who sends you out to serve your neighbor. It's a powerful name that's placed upon us. And even today, In a time when everything seems so uncertain, in a time where we would ask the question, God, where are you? What are you doing? Are you even present here? The very name of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the Trinity, the three-in-one relationship-oriented, unity-expressing God says, I am with you, even now. You see, we are not God, so we won't always know exactly what He is up to, but there are some things He does want us to know and remember that He is indeed doing. He's sustaining life as the Creator of all things. He's sharing a radical forgiveness and love as the one who has purchased back His people, His sinful people. He's redeemed them. And He's giving guidance, encouragement, and daily, daily presence through the one that has been sent as a helper, a comforter, a counselor. So I pray for you each and every day that you would first and foremost remember your identity is connected to the very name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That you can remember that you've been marvelously made by the Creator of the whole universe, that you were created in His image, and that you have been redeemed even now as one who may still on occasion wrestle with wandering away, that Jesus Christ has come and pursued you and redeemed you. And that when you feel like you're alone and isolated and you don't know what to do next, God, the Holy Spirit, is there in you and with you, giving you guidance, assuring you of the presence of God in your life, and strengthening you in faith, that you would cling to the promises of God that come with those who bear His name. I pray fervently that you would be encouraged by that presence of God each and every day, even now, and that you would remember the name that was placed upon you at your baptism. Remember who you are as a son and as a daughter of the Creator of the universe. I pray that in Jesus' holy name. Amen. May the peace that surpasses all human understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until we do indeed see Him face to face. Amen.
A regular part of our worship service when we are able to gather together is a returning back to God of our tithe and offerings, a portion of what He has given to us. In light of not being able to gather together, we invite you to take the opportunity. As you will see on the screen, there's a way to continue with your tithe and offering with online giving. There's also a way that you can do that through a text message to the church. And certainly, if you prefer to mail a check to the church office, that is acceptable as well. So you have three opportunities, whatever works best for you. Also on the screen, you will see the opportunity to let us know that you were in worship attendance with us today, and we very much would like to know, no matter where you may be, that you are here with us and have the opportunity to, that you may also include some prayer requests. Let us know if there's things that we can lift up either privately in prayer or things that we can lift up verbally in our worship services. We will continue our worship by singing the song, Who You Say I Am.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. His love for me, who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep.
One of the great opportunities we have as being gathered together as God's people in His church is to be able to give our prayers to Him, trusting in His promise to hear and answer each and every prayer according to His will. So we join together in the prayers of the church as well as the Lord's Prayer. Most gracious Lord, You are Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And even though we, in our human ways, maybe sometimes try to divide You out and separate You, we know that You are one God. You have given us the work of Your creation, the work of Your redemption, and the work of the Holy Spirit that brings us to faith and empowers us to live that faith out. But we know that You, as one God, work together in all these things as well. Lord, we pray that as we think about today and we ask every day, that You help us to grow closer to You in our relationship with You as the Triune God. And we also ask, Lord, that You help us to grow closer in those relationships with each other. Some of those that we know, our family, our friends, our co-workers, our neighbors, some that we may just simply encounter in passing through or standing in a line. And we ask, Lord, that You help us also to consider and grow in the relationships that we have with people we may never meet. Help us to see each person as someone You created, someone that Your Son, Jesus, was willing to die for, and someone that Your Holy Spirit calls each and every day. Lord, some of the family, the friends of Trinity that we ask that You watch over, we give those names and we give those prayers to You at this time, knowing that we have many more that are on our hearts and on our minds. We give You thanksgiving for the process that Kathy Nowak has been undergoing with her cancer treatment, and we pray, Lord, that that first step has been accomplished and great reports have been had. We also thank You for a successful surgery for Chad Sanders as he last week had a tumor removed from his brain. We pray, Lord, that You continue to watch over him as he goes through now those steps to rehabilitation. And we ask that You be with his family, his friends, those who provide care, and those who make the necessary adjustments for what that new life means. We pray, Lord, for Linda Novak and her healthcare team as she anticipates a hip replacement in the coming weeks. Continue to watch over her and keep her safe in Your care as she looks forward to that surgery and all we pray that that will do for her. We ask, Lord, that You be with all first responders and medical personnel. Be with those people who watch over Your people. And we ask that You protect them and keep them safe. We ask, Lord, for Your continued care and healing for Galen Thompson. We ask that You continue to watch over the recovery of Connie Foley from a back surgery. Protect Bonnie Siffert as she is recovering from an ankle surgery, and we pray that with that, that You would bring less and less pain each and every day. Lord, we give You thanks and we ask for Your continued blessings on Les Daniels as he had a heart procedure this past week. We thank You that things were headed off before serious damage happened, and now we pray that You continue to watch over him as he recovers from that, but also as he adjusts to what that may mean. Keep him safe. Lord, we pray for Lyle Edwards, and we ask that You be with him and Diane as they continue to find out more and more of what it means for Lyle to have the cancer diagnosis he has. And we ask, Lord, that You be with his doctors, those caregivers, that You give them wisdom and discernment to know how best to take care of Lyle. And we pray that You would be with Lyle and his body, that all the things that they do would work in that body that you created. Lord, we ask for your blessings on Pastor Billy and his family as they are traveling with the vacation. Give them safety. And we ask that you help them to enjoy that creation that you have made, that you have placed them in this week. Also, let this be a time of renewal and being focused continually on you and all the good that you do for them. And as they are enjoying that, we pray that you continue to watch over your good people here at Trinity. Lord, we know there are many things that we can thank you for, many things that you do for us. And we also know, Lord, that a result of that sin that came into the world is there is death in this life. And we pray that you would be with Noel and Jules and family upon the death of his wife, Donna, this past week. Evidence that there is physical death. But Lord, they were comforted in knowing that Donna had that faith in you, that trust in you, and that promise that she would be with you in paradise. And so we thank you for her faith. And we ask that you be with Nolan and family and give them your peace and comfort as they wait here for that day where they will join with Donna to be in your presence. We know, Lord, you do promise to answer each and every prayer according to your way, your will, and your time. Help us to trust in your will and to be patient as we wait. We also know, Lord, that you gave us your prayer as a model for how we can pray. And we lift that prayer up to you at this time. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we pray that God's word touch your hearts, your minds today, the songs that we sang touch your hearts and minds as well, that you would be blessed by that and that blessing would continue as you go from wherever you are gathered now. So as you do that, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing song today is Greater. And once again, we invite you following Greater. Gather the kids, gather the family around the TV, the computer, for Kids Corner. We look forward to that message today, God's creation and the triune God.
He's greater.
Welcome to Kids Corner, where we're taking a time out to bring the message home to your family. My name is Sarah Halava, and I am part of the children's ministry team here. This is my daughter, Ella.
Hi.
And my other daughter, Addison. We're so excited to be here with you today. And if you don't know us, a little bit about us, we moved to Bloomington, Illinois about a year ago from what I call God's greatest creation, or where the place where God likes to show off the most, Loveland, Colorado. And as much as I miss my mountains, I am so excited to be here with you and part of this wonderful faith community. Well, today is Trinity Sunday, which means we praise and celebrate God for who He is, and we remember all that He has done. I want you to look out your window. What do you see? Maybe you see some tall trees, you see some green grass, some beautiful flowers. Maybe you see some birds, or if you were sitting in our backyard, bunnies, lots and lots of bunnies. All those things are part of God's creation. I want to teach you a fun song about creation. The first time, go ahead and just repeat after me, and then we'll sing it together. All right, Ella, are you ready?
Yeah.
Repeat after me. In the beginning, God made the sea.
In the beginning, God made the sea.
And the forest filled with trees.
And the forest filled with trees.
He made the mountains up so high.
He made the mountains up so high.
And above it all, he placed the sky. His fingerprints are everywhere. Just to show how much he cares. And in the middle, God had some fun. He made a hippo that weighed a ton. Hip, hip, hippopotamus. Hip, hip, hooray, God made all of us. Hip, hip, hippopotamus. Hip, hip, hooray, God made all of us. Awesome. Okay, are you guys ready? Let's sing it together. In the beginning, God made the sea and the forest filled with trees. He made the mountains up so high. Above it all, he placed the sky. God's fingerprints are everywhere.
just to show how much he cares. And in the middle, God had some fun. He made a hippo that weighed a ton.
Hip, hip, hippopotamus.
Hip, hip, hooray, God made all of us.
Hip, hip, hippopotamus.
Hip, hip, hooray, God made all of us. Awesome. Great job, guys. Go ahead and take a seat. Do you remember that line from the hippo song? God's fingerprints are everywhere just to show how much he cares. God's creation is one way that God leaves his fingerprints so we can always remember that he cares for us. It is a reminder that God, our creator, provides for us and takes care of us. We can see God's fingerprints in so many places, but sometimes our actions try to hide God's fingerprints. Maybe we say a mean thing to a friend or even a stranger. Maybe we don't listen to our moms or our dads or our teachers. Maybe we don't treat our husband or wife the way they deserve to be treated. Yep. Even adults sin. But sin can't hide God's fingerprints. God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross to take away all our sins. Jesus is our Redeemer. Jesus rescued us from our sin. And when Jesus died on the cross, all our sins were forgiven and we can forgive others. And while Jesus was here on earth, he left his fingerprints too. He taught about his Father in heaven. He healed the sick. He fed the hungry. He even raised the dead. And before he went back up to heaven, he gave us a very important message. Let's read about what our Redeemer said in Matthew 28. Here we go. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Jesus wants us to leave his fingerprints on the world. He wants us to go and make disciples. How do we do that? I want to show you something. This is a fun activity that you and your family can do later today. You'll need an index card, a pencil, and some scotch tape. Take your index card and rub the pencil on your index card, like so. Get it nice and thick. And take your finger and just press it into the index card. Roll it back a little bit and you'll get your fingertip completely covered. Take a piece of scotch tape and then place it over your fingertip and press. And then you're going to take your scotch tape and slowly peel it off. Uh-oh. And go ahead and place it on your index card. Now I want to show you something. I did this with my family earlier today. There's Ella's fingerprint, there's Addison's fingerprint, and there's my fingerprint. Notice that our fingerprints are not the same, even though we're related. Did you know that there's no one else in the entire world who has the same fingerprint as you do? When God created you, he created you to be exactly who you are. He created you with your own gifts, your own abilities, and your own talents. And he gave you the gift of the Holy Spirit to help you use your gifts. The Holy Spirit
our helper equips us. He empowers us, and he helps us use those gifts to help others see, know, and follow Jesus, to be a disciple. We were created to be the hands and feet of Jesus, so that all our friends and all our neighbors can see God's fingerprints and know that he cares for them. Thanks, friends. Go and have a fantastic week. Bye-bye.
Hey, everyone. Good morning again. Hey, join me in a big shout-out to the Halava family for such a great job of bringing the message home this morning. Well, Stella and I are back here to bring us into prayer before our discussion questions. Please join us. Fold your hands and bow your heads. Lord Jesus, we celebrate and praise you for who you are. Thank you for all you have done for us. Thank you especially for leaving your fingerprints everywhere for us, even if we don't always see them. Please open our eyes to see them when we fail. Send your Holy Spirit so that we can use our gifts to leave our fingerprints on others to your glory. We love you. Amen. All righty, here we go into this week's questions. Got them, Stella? Okay, here we go. Where do you see God's fingerprints in your life? Oh, I'm looking around. I know they're out there. You look around your place too. Here's number two. Who was someone who left their fingerprint on you, and how did they show it? And here's our last one. How can you leave your fingerprints, and on whom? Some more good questions for family discussion. So there you have those questions for your family discussion. So right now, Stella and I are gonna sign off, and we wish you God's blessings on this next week coming up. Bye now.